I will share with you on how to conduct and determine process capability studies CP or CPK for attribute data in this video. It is simpler than you think. I will walk you through the fundamentals of process capability studies before I go into the process capability studies of attribute data. Do subscribe to this channel to learn about manufacturing and quality engineering applications in real life experience in manufacturing line. Process capability study is to compare the voice of the process or process variations. Every process, they have their own variations with the voice of the customers, which is the specifications limit. We shall learn more about that in the subsequent slides. It is an objective measurement on how well the process is able to produce products or parts which meet customers' specification, and it is able to estimate the defect rate of products which fail to meet specs and provide a valuable insights if variability is a problem or mean is a problem or both is a problem that we are unable to meet the specs and therefore needs improvement. Let's understand what is control limit, which is voice of the process VOP, and specification limit, which is the voice of the customers. The voice of the process VOP is represented by the control limit, because control limit is calculated from the process variations, which is upper control limit and lower control limits. As stated, control limits are calculated from the process data itself, the process variations and the mean, and represents what the current process state is. That means what it is capable of doing, how many good parts are is capable of producing, and can only be changed if there is a process change or process improvement, which the signal in the control charts will tell us if there is a common cause or special cause variation. I have put in a link to my YouTube video to explain, which explains more about common cause and special cause. Do check out that video if you would like to understand more about common cause and special cause. Whereas in the voice of the customers, it is represented by specs limit, upper specs limit and lower specs limit. The specification limits are actually derived based on customers or engineering requirements. That means somebody assigns a specs to it and represents what we want the process to do. Means that the process has to meet the specification limits or specification goals and can be changed if there's changing requirements. And the specification limit is actually used to separate good and bad parts. That means those that beyond the specification limits are considered as a reject parts. We shall start by looking at the process capability studies in variable or continuous process parameters to understand the fundamentals of process capability studies. This is the illustration of the concept for process capability. In this diagram here, we have the voice of the process in red here, which is lower control limit and upper control limit. And we have the voice of the customers, which is represented by lower specs limit and upper specs limit, USL. As you can see that if we have the voice of the process, the variation is smaller than the total specs tolerance, then we consider this as a good process. In another scenario, we have the voice of the process. The variation or the spread is very big. It's bigger than the voice of the customers. Therefore, anything that is beyond the specs, the LSL and USL, it will consider as a defect. This type of process is not desirable in any manufacturing process because the potential of producing defects is very high, and definitely there will be defect. The CPK index value are actually corresponding to a defect PPM. If we look at the sigma level of 2.5, which is a CPK of 0.33, this means that we will have about 160K reject here, meaning that this is what it looks like. This is the specs limit. That means we will have a lot of parts which is out of the specs limit, either on the upper specs or on the lower specs. That will depends if the CPK is CPU or CPL. If the sigma level is 3.5, which is corresponding to a CPK of 0.66, means that we will have about 22.75K of reject, which is still high. And then at 4 sigma level with a CPK of 0.83, we will have about 6,000 plus PPM. And at 4.5, which is at 1.0 CPK level, we will have 1,350 PPM of reject. This is actually an opportunity of reject. So at 5.0, we will have about 1.16, which is corresponds to a reject rate of 232. And at 5.5 sigma level, which is the most desirable CPK value, and we always heard about CPK value of 1.33, the PPM should be around 31.5 PPM, means that there are very little chance for reject, and means that the process is very good, is inside the specs limit, and the chances of it to go outside is very little. Therefore, there will be less reject here. And at the famous Six Sigma level, the CPK is around 1.64, corresponds to 3.4 PPM rejects. The process capability study purpose is to use the CPK to estimate the process reject rate based on the statistical principles of z-test for a continuous normal distributed data. We can then predict the process reject rate for the future process or a product parameter that we cannot measure 100%. In order to know the process capability value for an attribute data, we will need to calculate the reject rate. such as from an inspection process. Once we have the reject rate, we can already find out the CPK value using a statistical software or manually through a statistic Z table. We can then match the PPM with the potential, the CPK value here. There are quite a number of opinions regarding whether CPK or PPK for attribute data can be calculated. Some guru will tell you to use the yield data. Once we understand the fundamentals of process capability study, which is used to estimate the potential reject from a process, my take would be there's no need to calculate the PPK data anymore. We would already know the reject rate of the attribute data collection directly. You can use the reject rate or PPM to reverse engineer to process sigma, to determine the process sigma, and also find the process capability from the table I give you in the earlier slides. I hope that you have a better understanding on the purpose of process capability study and also whether process capability study is needed for attribute data. Do like and subscribe to this channel to be notified about the future video. You can leave me a comment to let me know what is your problem in process capability study and I shall reply. Thank you for watching this video.